passe. Ouais, super, super, l'artiste. Super, encore un but sensationnel. That's a brilliant bit of follow-up play by Mahé. Oh my goodness me, what a shot.
Sagosen.
Sagosen setter det hen. Han setter den. De I semifinale igjen.
Extra time drama in the bronze medal matches. Jovika Radičević signs off with a medal at the end of her Montenegrin career. That drains all the energy out of the arena, and we somehow have to play a final minutes later. Denmark look great for 45 minutes, but then realize they're about to win the European Championship. And Norway win the title for a ninth time in 15 attempts. It's the Uninformed Handball Hour live on Twitch with our final podcast of the championship. It's Chris O'Reilly here and Alex Kulesh to my left, right beside me. And Alex, but first of all, hello.
Hi, Chris.
been here all day.
Welcome back. We've been broadcasting together for about 6 hours, but those of you listening on the recorded podcast, this is the end of our reign here in the studio. And as is now tradition at the end of these tournaments, while Brian Campion, our third man, is running around the arena like a madman, we bring in a bit of subtle class into the trio with Nedzad Smajlagic in.
Yeah, I will take that.
Welcome, Nedzad. How you doing?
Thank you, Chris. Yeah, amazing. And thank you for having me once again.
It's a joy to have you back on. Where do we start? We'll start at the top. Shall we? Top of the podium.
We have to start with the final, even though the third place match was the big highlight of the day, I think. So final. I'm still trying to react to it because I feel a little bit deflated, to be honest.
Yeah. That hit you hard.
It did. I think a lot of hope came into me, and I realized as the match went on just how much I wanted Denmark to win. You know what happens sometimes. You're like, oh, I don't really mind. I want a nice final. I want a nice game. And after actually being exhausted from the third place playoff and getting into the game and watching Denmark play wonderful handball, they played just this beautiful flowing style. Mm. Getting the ball out, making gaps, getting it to the wing, shooting over when needed. It just looked amazing. But there was just no one was comfortable at halftime, right? There was no one that was comfortable. And everyone kind of expected Norway to just come back because that's what they do. Did you expect that, Nedzad?
Yeah, I did. I mean, I really liked how Denmark played, I must admit. I really liked the first half. They dominated Norway. I don't know if you guys agree with me. I saw it like that. I saw Norway in a really bad situation because I think we spoke after the first half, and I said it's very hard for Norway to play when you have in the first half a really bad performance from Stine Oftedal and Henny Reistad. So that's like two key players. In the second half, I was really lucky to be really close to the court, and you can feel the tension that Danish players had, and also the bench. Even though, as Chris said, they played like the first 15 minutes of the second half, also quite good. There's this kind of good cushion with +3, +4 margin, which was okay. And then, Katrina Lunde in a way took over. Yeah. And again, as Chris perfectly said, I think the fear of maybe we will be the European champions. What then?
All spot on. I think I want to go back first to that first half because you mentioned there the fact that Henny Reistad and Oftedal were basically non-factors in it. Nora Merck was kind of single-handedly dragging them through. But Denmark looked so damn comfortable in attack and in defense, but most importantly in attack, which just looked so impressive, and they looked completely fearless. And somehow, at the end of that 30 minutes, there were only 3 goals up, and I still don't understand why.
I'll tell you why.
Tell me, please.
The 7-6 didn't work. It gave Norway energy in the middle of that half, and it reduced the score to just 3 when it didn't look like it. Because
it was 2 empty net goals.
In a row, and I don't remember the exact score at the time, but it basically, Norway had only scored 5 goals after 21 minutes. And they got 2 in a row, got it up to 7. Mm-hmm. So that just gave Norway energy out of nowhere. And my key for Denmark winning a medal was the 7-on-6 working. It did the first time they beat Norway. it didn't today.
Yeah. You made a point just before we went on about midway through that second half where they were kind of flip-flopping about whether to go 7-6 again. What was your perspective?
Yeah, no, I was really looking closely at the bench. They played, I think, 2 attacks, 7-6. It was okay. They were a bit lucky because Rastad missed the empty net goal. And then there was a really, for me, because I was looking a lot at, on the bench and on Jensen, there was a huge confusion. Should we send a 7 player? Which 7 player are we missing? Is the line player or backcourt player? Nobody was sure. Sander Toft, I think, went in and went out for 3 times. Then there was always a full substitution. And from that point on time, it may be now stupid to say because Norway obviously win. I was quite sure that Norway would win. Mm. Because on Norway's bench, I just saw really calm faces. Even though, I don't know, I remember, I think Malin Onne missed 3 or 4 shots in a row when they have a really good opportunity to come back. Because it's always like Denmark has a 2-goal margin or 3-goal margin. Norway comes to 2, then Denmark again 3. And then for me, just to wrap this up, to really my huge, huge congratulations to the Norway bench in the most crucial, moments, but the one point in the second half, they put Oftedal out, they put Breistol in, and she scores a goal to equalize and then a goal to put them in front. I thought that was the first time that Norway is in front. No, it was before. I think the Arendal scored an empty net goal. Yep. As Alex said, so 7-6 was a problem. And this mastermind coaching, from my perspective, to put Breistol in, take Oftedal out, she scores 2 goals, they are in front, and then Norway is comfortable. Then the game goes in their direction.
It's not the obvious thing to do, and that's what we discussed as well. We were wondering, okay, why in this situation when Raista is clearly not having a good game at all, but she's being forced in there, Breistol comes in, and then I thought about it, and I was like, okay, they have the 2 big shooters in there, because nothing else is working. The speed and moving with the ball that Denmark were comfortable with. So we're just going to go route one. And almost as soon as that was said, Breistol scores the first of those 2 goals. And it's like, that changes things. And then finally, then the last few minutes, Oftedal can come in.
I would like to ask the coach if the purpose was also to put her in attack. Because I thought in the first seconds, okay, he wants her in defense because she's big. Let's stop 7-6. Let's make the spaces closer. Let's put a lot of hands there. But then she went in attack.
So yeah.
2 out of 2 in, I don't know, 2 minutes. And that was it.
So. But Denmark's defense was also just so good in that first half. I think throughout the game, still, it was good. They made this unbelievable middle block. And gave everything to the wings. And in the first half, Norway just refused to give the ball to the wings. Nuremberg, the amount of times that to her right was about 3 meters of space as Emma Friis was literally standing right in front of her, the right winger, always free. Nuremberg would still go inside and try to make something happen. And sometimes she still did. She somehow got it to the line a bunch of times. She got through a bunch of times. But that middle block was compact and keeping Norway out. Instead of going through it or around it, Norway decided to go over it. And it worked. And eventually, they did start spreading the play outside. The wingers getting the ball a little bit. But in the end, the wingers were a weakness for Norway, just 50% shooting for Andersen and Malin Aune on the right wing as well. Yeah. And it was the right coaching decision from Denmark and the right defensive decision to let those shoot. But when Norway actually started spreading their attack a little bit, it helped them.
Yeah. Yeah. Spot on. And I'm just wondering, like, hearing all of this and discussing this, is like, besides the mental side of it, what Denmark could have done differently? Because, you know, conceding 27 goals, you have a chance to win. You know, if you consider also how many goals they scored in the previous encounter, you see how many goals they scored in the first half here. They were on course. If everything went normally and the attack kept doing what it was doing before, maybe that answers the question. It is only mental what they could have done differently to
fine margins.
Yeah,
fine margins. And as you were saying, Denmark needed to be 90-95% today.
Yeah.
And they were 85-90, and it's just not enough at the highest level to beat Norway, who still didn't have the best game.
No, and that's it. It was like, it's still early in that second half when you expect Norway, like they did against France in the World Championship final last year, just 4 goals straight away, boom, turn the game around. That didn't happen. Norway had an extra player, extra woman for 2 minutes, didn't get a goal from it. And you're like, oh, all these things are actually going Denmark's way. Yet still, Denmark aren't putting it to bed, and Norway just have new things to try. Then Lunde comes in.
Yeah.
Then Bryson comes in. They keep creating Shri these
Lunde,
other things.
The cheat code.
Yeah, I mean, I was on that side. So she came in, and when Chris asked, like, what Denmark could have done differently, I had a feeling that they didn't want to shoot out from, like, 7 or 8 meters. I had her, because Anna Mette Hansen was really close to the defense. Her foot was, like, at 7-meter line. Mm. And if you, as Anna Mette Hansen, don't want to shoot from there, I think that it was not only Katrine Lunde, but a mixture of fear to win the championship combined with Katrine Lunde, then combined with Emma Fries missing, let's say, her third shot in the entire tournament. But the shot.
Today.
I mean, Lunde did not... I think she made 3 spectacular saves, 2 which were okay, and she received, I think, 4 goals that she would normally save. So it was like not a save percentage, but like the saves in the perfect time. And for me, it was because I was watching the first half with Duda Amorim, and I was saying that if Louise Burgard plays defense for Denmark, then Norway should attack her. Because, she's always been changing, not the perfect defensive player, but also in attack. I was not quite sure how she will handle this. Then she played really good first half. And then in the second half, that was double fault, technical mistake at +2 for Norway. Okay, the last shot was... I will not mention it. But before that was a technical mistake that maybe then just finish it off for Norway.
Yeah, that's, in a way, for Denmark, quite devastating. I mean, I think you're going to feel it for a while, Alex.
I think so. It's
only now, I mean, it's in these tough moments that you realize that that's where your heart lay.
Yeah, and I've been enamored with this team, I think. Speaking to them as well and kind of being around them throughout this tournament has, I don't know, they have some nice characters in the team and they have this nice team spirit. And I just feel bad for Sandra Toft. I watching her tears after the semi-final was just this beautiful moment where, like, all the tension was just released. Like, years of tension for Toft was released, and she just couldn't hold back the tears. Then, into this final, that moment where the shot went through her hands, and that was it. She was done. She knew the game was over.
The shot from Rijstad.
It was a shot from Rijstad. And Rijstad had a bad game. But she had a really bad game.
3 from 8.
But
two of those goals coming in the last 10 minutes, crucially, right? You just got to wonder what it'll be like for Sandra going back into training with Jurrit and seeing Oftedal and just like...
Yeah, there was a clash. But there was a really close contact between Anna Mette Hansen and Oftedal in the last minute. So, I mean. But, Alex, I know that you adore Sandra Toft. She played an amazing tournament. But was there a smallest reason for Jensen maybe to put Althea Reinhardt in the last 10 minutes?
I think that might have...
She was warming up.
She was.
I
think it might have been... I don't know. As I asked her as well, it felt like... this tournament, Sandra Toft was absolute number one. Number two, if needed, was Althea Reinhardt. Compared to the last tournaments, where it was quite equally split, I asked if that was something that was a conscious decision. And Sandra said no.
Yeah, you can't know this thing. Yeah,
you can't know this thing. It's just her performances. And not, you know, it's a little bit strange because we talk about the special positions for each Danish player and the special talks and have. And it's a bit strange for me that... this kind of decision to keep Sandra on at all times wasn't communicated, so maybe it was. But I felt that if you allowed Althea a little bit more time in this tournament, maybe you'd be more confident with bringing her on. Just when Norway were just starting to turn the screw, you could have brought Althea on. And Althea can do something special. She can make a big save.
Yeah, I mean, she's also like, she's bigger. So the probability that these balls from Breistel or Reistad will just hit her somewhere in the hand are a bit higher. Yeah. But I mean, now it's obviously for us easy to say. So
Just quickly on looking at the future here for these two teams, and what's quite scary. I mean, it's scary what Norway have done over the last few years, but now they've just played a final where they were like, I don't know, 7 out of 10, or with a championship where they've had seven newcomers in the team and not have the same rotation and flow as usual, but still managed to pull it out of the bag in the final weekend. And that says a lot about the team and the mentality and the coaching and the key players, like Nora Merck.
It says it right? about the top players, because yeah. we talk about these seven players that come in, but they barely played. Like, they really didn't contribute too much throughout the tournament. They put away their shots in the rare times the wingers got the ball.
The wings were new, and Ingstad wasn't new, but she was the first
really
choice line player for
that,
the first time.
That is true. I think the big player that stepped up, and they needed her to step up in this tournament, was Ingstad. Yeah. I agree with that. But overall, it was what? Just Merck, Oftedal, and Henny constantly just stepping up for them.
For me, it was the number 33. I was just not Googling her name. I was just going to the stats. It's the Dela, the 22-year-old from Molde, who played quite decent. Not a lot of minutes, but the minutes that she became, that she played, were really good both in defense and attack.
She's in defense,
really good,
especially.
Yeah, because in second defense. Half, she had this... I think at the beginning of the second half, she had this a pass to line player, really good one. And also in this, at 22 years old from Molde. So that's like something. I really like her because I noticed her also in the semifinals. There was like one against one situation that she, I will just say Luisa Burgard for Eduarda, and then I will stop. Sorry. But yeah, played for me, I will not say a crucial role, but really good for, let's say, 5, 7, or 10 minutes that she become.
Yeah,
but it's scary that they can still come out on top after all of that.
Yeah,
and for Denmark then, what does the future hold for them? We said fourth, third, second now in consecutive tournaments. They've experienced the final now. They've experienced the heartbreak. That can be a very good thing for them as well. They seem to be a team that are learning lessons all the time and developing all the time. Will it be the same again for next year?
I think they need to find their star.
Yes, you mentioned the star.
I think
the star?
They just need it.
Yes.
It's
what qualifies as a star?
The
as in not Sandra Toft, like you need a backcourt star.
A backcourt star.
Okay.
Yeah. Just a backcourt star. And they need one to just take the game by the scruff of the neck when it's needed, like Nora Merck did today. When no one was firing around her, she just said, "I'm going to win this game." And we've seen different players for Norway step up. They have a bunch of stars that do it. And right now for Denmark, Jesper Jensen's the star. Because it's the systems that are working so well. The, you know, the crucial kind of scruff and neck moments is, okay, we're going to go 7-on-6 now. That's a coaching decision. They drew up a play and that was that beautiful in-flight goal for Luisa Burgard. That was Jesper Jensen doing that. And of course, Sandra Toft is a star. So, but an outfield player needs to just take more shots and kind of will the team to win. And out of those backcourt players, I don't know who it is really. I think they all have a chance to do it.
I would tip Mia Hörlund.
Yeah.
I think she has that mentality. I think she had a bad luck with a couple of injuries. So she had, I think 3 years ago, Chris, maybe really good season in the Champions League. Then there were a couple of injuries, and then she's slowly coming back. In my opinion, the things that I saw now really close to the court, she is the one that has this charisma and obviously intelligence and handball skills and everything. But she is the one that your eyes got stuck on when Denmark plays. So.
She can at a given time do anything, which is a great thing. And just looking here at the ages of the squad here, so Mia Hoyland there, 25 years old, just turned 25. Right. Then you have Michaela Muller, who's kind of the wild card of the team at the moment, 22, still incredibly young. Christina Jurgensen, 24. Mette Tranborg, 26. So you have... And then Simona Pedersen, who showed as well what she's capable of against Norway, 25. So they've got 22, 24, 25, 25, 26. That's a team with another, you know, 7-8 years in it.
But they need
to
be allowed...
Will one or two of them take over?
But they need to be allowed to take over, I think. We talk about Mia Hoyland here. Mm. And in this tournament, she got such a specific role of coming in just an attack. She plays defensive in defense for her club.
Yeah.
Many times she, multiple times, takes over 10 shots a game. That's something that she does and can do. But she was told in this tournament, you're playing after the transition phase in the set attack, and that's where we need you.
Yeah.
and it worked to an extent, but to win a final, it's, you know, I don't want to be too critical because, you know, they were...
That system got them to the final.
But I think, it's hard to compare, but I think you still need a star to win those big games.
Yeah, but it needs
Lena Hogstad.
Your favorite player.
I
wanted to say maybe it's obviously it's not only the national level. It needs to have something with the club competition. Yeah. Or the club choice. So is it maybe the best thing to move to a top club, maybe to win the Champions League, and in that case to form yourself to come back to Denmark as a star to the national team? I mean, as a star, is maybe that a factor? I don't want to say that Team Esbjerg. Yeah. Or any other Danish, obviously, Vipers are winning the Champions League. But
Team Esbjerg could win it, but then the star is going to be Henny Reistad.
Yeah,
right.
That's
the support cast.
Maybe
for
Mia
Norwegian.
In 2 or 3 years in Gjør, and then you earn your reputation, and then you come back as a star with the national team.
That's a good point, and it's a good position to be in. There's the option, there's a possibility for all those players. I can see any of those players being that, but all of them have bought into being in a system. So whatever happens, whatever that system may evolve into, whether it's someone like Hurland, who's the run and gun, 10, 12 shots a game, then the rest of the team will support that if it means winning a championship, because that's really what it's about at the end of the day. Now that they've tasted bitter defeat. I've had this message here for a while. Brian coming up might make it to live. Clemens, is Brian coming up? Oh, the message is gone. So maybe let's talk about the bronze medal game, because I want to get your perspective on the bronze medal game as a fellow Balkan.
Yeah, I mean, I would say it like this. I'm really sorry for Gras Adi, and I'm extremely happy for Montenegro. I'm extremely happy for the entire country, for their fans. I think I said it on Friday evening to my colleague. The bronze medal game will be, normally it's not so spectacular, but the Montenegrin fans will make it even more spectacular. They were a bit lucky also that today there was a football game between Montenegro and Slovenia, right. So there were even more fans here. I know that the girls from Montenegro like to use words like energy, like passion. I saw that on the court. I don't want to say that France did not have the energy. I don't want to say that France did not wanted to win, but there's always this commentary sentence that commentators say, not Chris, but some average commentators. I think that Montenegro just wanted it slightly more today to be on the.
It was one of those classic bronze medal
question for you, Chris.
Hippie, yeah.
What do Montenegro have to do to win a medal at this championship?
We just saw it. That's a question Alex has been asking for 2 weeks. My answer has always been yes. I don't know if I ever gave the definitive answer. Key parts of it was to phone it in against France. They ended up doing that against Netherlands. They did the opposite of it. They didn't protect their squad. They damaged it even further, as Milena Rajčević couldn't play in the bronze medal game today. But they managed to go somehow even deeper into the squad. I mean, players.
Can I answer that question?
Go on.
I think that, especially today, Montenegro needed a crazy game. Montenegro needed today more than just a handball game. Because if they play a normal handball game against France, without Rajčević, they will lose. Yeah. Today was not a normal handball game. Today was everything besides a normal handball game. And that's something that Montenegro needed today and got today with the red card of Grbić. Before that, with craziness and penalties and whatever, they got that. And they were a bit more luckier, I would say.
Yeah. And I just want to recap this, that crazy game, because traditionally the bronze medal game is a game that a lot of people don't watch. And they missed out at an absolute showcase. It was an extra time victory for Montenegro, 27-25. At full time, it was 22-22 after Montenegro went into the lead with about 5 seconds left. Jokovic dragging her destroyed body somehow into a 9-meter shot and scoring to make it 22-21. Yeah. France got the ball and were starting a fast break. But Grbić decided to just stop play in the last 3 seconds. Basically, ran over to Edvige, I think, grabbed her arm, and a penalty was given and a red card was given to Gerbich, according to the rules.
A senseless decision
for Gerbich.
But somehow it worked out in the end.
Yeah. Grassadi stepped up. Nerves of steel, ice in her veins, put the penalty in. It went to extra time. And here we are thinking, France have to win it. Montenegro had 6.5 players. Now they have 5.5 players with Gerbic getting a red card. And they just didn't. How did Montenegro win that extra time period?
Somehow they were calm about the whole situation.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I wanted to say France was more nervous. Not nervous. France was focused because there was a scene after Zadi scored. Sercé Nogolan went, I think, to do a bit of trash talk towards the Montenegro players. And then the coach like shouted at her for the next 15 seconds. So basically, the first 30 seconds after Zadi scored, they were not focused on handball. Yeah. They were not focused, hey, let's gather, let's see what we will play. The coach was focused on collecting the players because they involved this trash talk and whatever was happening with the Montenegrin players and the referees and fans. There was, again, craziness all over the place.
There was things thrown on the court, which isn't good.
Yeah, never.
And we talked to Cleopatra Darlow after the semi-final, and they said that they let the referees get in their head in that semi-final against Norway. Some decisions went against them, and they let Norway get ahead. There wasn't any complaints I heard from any fans in that game that the referees did a bad job. In this game, there was some mistakes, I think. Nothing as blatant as we've seen before. But from my perspective, France should not have been allowed Montenegro to be in this game. They won by 9 goals the first time they played. They have a squad that's much wider, much stronger, much younger than this Montenegrin team. And they allowed them to stick in the game. And decisions, went either way. I actually, I don't really look at referees in games like this. And I didn't notice anything just completely wrong.
No, I mean, they were still making calls. I mean, France had a penalty, they equalized. France had two penalties in extra time. One of them was missed.
I didn't understand the backcourt line. I didn't understand the strategy in the last, 10 minutes of the regular time and then in the extra time with Zeminko Zadi without the left-hander on the right back. And, I mean, kudos to Montenegro and also kudos to Norway for stopping the line player, for stopping Foppa. Because it looked like all of the teams were better, both Norway and Montenegro were better prepared than France to meet their opponents than France was. Because Foppa did not make a difference in any of these games. Because today Montenegro stopped her totally. And let's not forget one fact. I think in 10th minute, or let's say in the first 15 minutes, Tatjana Brnovic got her second 2 minutes penalty. And she played until the end. How can you not isolate her and just put, I don't know, Kanor and Zeminko every single attack? Because if you take Brnovic out, then, in my opinion, it's game.
She was
game
the one scoring the goals. She was the one who.
And you spoke to her after the game as well, right? This would be a good time to go into that conversation with Brnovic. Yes.
Tatjana Brnovic, first of all, it's hard to take a breath right now. Can you sum up what you're experiencing into words?
I would say that I cannot believe that we are returning a medal from European Championship in Montenegro after 8 years, after this match. Sorry for this. But really, it describes our happiness. Really, it's beyond words. We are so happy and satisfied, I don't know.
After this incredibly difficult 2.5 weeks, everything you've gone through, and then as we saw Milena bouncing around now but couldn't play today with that neck injury, I mean, how did you find the hope and how did you find the inspiration to pull this off today?
I mean, from this whole tournament we were sticking together, never we were apart all through difficulties, and with our amazing fans which were following us from home through Skopje to here, they were giving the bond for us also, and we were finding strength in each other. And also we dedicate every victory for the girls here, for like Milena, who couldn't play today, also some girls who stayed home. This is for them, and this is something that we are really, really, really proud of.
Talk to me a little bit about the tactical approach. You played France just a week ago, and it was a completely different game today. How did you manage to keep them under control?
First, we analyzed that last game. We had too many technical mistakes, like 22, of which 9 was like in their hands. It was a clear contra. So we today took it slow. When it was a clear shot for the contra, we took it. But the rest, we took it easy, calm, steady attack. And we benefited from that. We gave space for our backs, and after they gave the ball all around, and I think we did a really good job.
And there's been a lot of talk about the depth of the team, and even with another big player missing today, but today it was so many big contributions throughout the squad.
Yes, we were running everywhere, like one attack, we were changing on one attack, one defense, numbers in defense, they were not there, didn't matter. We were just giving our heart out with a calm and steady mind, which I think was really the thing which decided. We didn't go with our emotions, we just kept straight goal, which we had, and we just walked towards it.
It would have been really understandable if there was maybe a bit of heartbreak after that equalizing goal at the end. What did you talk about in the team?
Maybe you saw all of us praying, like praying like we were in church. But that was the moment we took. We hoped that it can end there. But as soon as the goal entered the net, we were just like, it's okay. We continue. We're not surrendering now after this big fight. It was just a small stop where we put our faith, but we didn't even think of surrendering or giving up. We just
You look so composed as well as a team, and you were a focal point in that extra time as well in the attack. I mean, how are you feeling as these balls were coming into you? You look so composed. Clutch.
Yeah, I don't know what to say, really. It was like all around the adrenaline hitting, catching, striking. I don't know what happened in the end there, but I'm really, really happy because of this medal.
You really deserve it. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Before we let you go then, and before we wrap up here on the live stream, reflecting on the tournament as a whole from your perspective, I don't know what teams you followed in particular, what stood out for you, any you know, teams or players that have really impressed you beyond what we saw this weekend?
I mean, I must admit that even though Montenegro won the bronze medal game, it's for me it's still impressive and a bit scary how far away are Scandinavians from, I will not say the rest of the world. I was very disappointed from Hungary, I must admit, even though they won the last game. I was expecting way more. But okay, they decided to play the entire tournament with a lot of young players. I think that Romania stepped up. It will be tricky, obviously, now when Neagu is gone. It will be tricky to see how this team will develop. But for me, someone who is from the Balkans, Slovenia put up a good fight. Croatia put up a good fight. But all of the three teams, I'm a fan of Montenegro because I have a connection there and I like the country. I did not like how they played. I must admit that. Both Montenegro, Croatia and Slovenia played, I mean, Serbia, obviously, play, in my opinion, the old school handball, which is not attractive. This final game is a different level, and I think we need to face. I don't want to speak about bad things.
Yeah.
So for me, that's one of the key facts. Personally, how far away are the Scandinavians? Let's not forget Sweden played an amazing tournament. Amazing
Sweden game. Could have been the honorary bronze medal, right?
Flying all over the place. Netherlands also with some kind of interesting squad. Polman coming back. The main point, as Chris previously said, regarding the age of the Danish players, regarding the age of the Norwegian players, the courage of both coaches to put 22, 21, 23 years old in 45th minute in the final game, that is something that I think we all need to take from this. And I must say, this final day is the best commercial for handball. Amazing bronze medal game, amazing crowd, because I heard a lot of stuff, the arena will be empty. It was not empty, it was not fully packed, but it was not empty, and the final game was just like a cherry on the top. So I would maybe, it's maybe a bit cheesy, but I think it speaks volumes for women's handball in general, from women's EHF Euro, and it was amazing to end up the tournament like this.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
One of the things that I usually take away from these tournaments is just the stars, and it makes me, you know, they stand out. You mean a Roberts, Nora Merck, many. It's just like, there's too many of them to just name.
Foppa, but you know, Tof, but like Sandertoff,
Sandertoff, Folletta Foppa, all of these names we've talked about.
Didn't even mention Rijsdal.
But you know, all of these names that we've been talking about throughout this competition, and you just focus in on all of these players, and you realize how amazing they are, and you kind of realize exactly what they're good at, how they do it. You see them up close. It was my first ever live international women's handball game. And sitting in right beside the court for Sweden versus
Norway
was just a shock for me, because I just realized how fast, how powerful, how high they jump, how fast they throw. And it's something that maybe doesn't translate fully towards TV. Handball is always more impressive in real life, and you just see how incredible that is. But you just watch these stars, you follow them, and you want to keep following them. So kind of going into the rest of the club season, for example, I just, you know, I have the players that have been my favorite in this tournament, which I may not have been fully, you know, conscious of in the club game. And I want to just go out and just follow them, understand how they play in their own clubs, how the season progresses, and just cheer for them. Yeah. So it's the stars that really stood out for me.
Nice. For me then, just before, we'll get Brian's as well after the break for the podcast listeners. It seems like for all the big teams, a first step towards the Olympics for them. So in that way, it's quite exciting because, as you said, it's young squads there. Some coaches being very brave in terms of developing teams. I would even put Slovenia in that category as well, because for the first time it's a team, not just relying on Anna Gross. And oh my goodness me, Brian Campion is coming in.
Oh yeah,
we'll see if he's willing to join us straight away.
Full of energy.
And,
Look at this energy.
A bundle of energy.
What a bundle of energy coming in.
Perfect timing. Want to grab a seat and join us?
Just as we were wrapping up.
I'll say goodbye. You're coming in. So.
You stay with us until the end. Nedzad, come on. We'll shift over and let Brian in.
There's a chair back there.
Oh yeah, just so I can. Maybe you shouldn't make a break. To
shift out there.
Oh, we're going the other way.
This is
great. Yeah.
One for you.
That's top quality. We had
enough live content for people.
Oh, yes. Okay. To have a think about your impression of the tournament, what is like, you know, what is standing with you now that we're at the end of it?
Yeah, what do you take away from the tournament? And what are your impressions?
And I'll finish my thoughts.
Chris does that.
So where was I? So teams kind of starting a new journey towards what is a shortened Olympic cycle, which makes it really interesting because I think a lot of top players were coming to the end of things for Tokyo. Then it was delayed by a year, so there was kind of like, this development for younger players had to be halted for a year, so some groups of players could come to an end because it's very cyclical. So we're seeing that now with the top teams. Slovenia, a great example of that, because they have all this talent. And I think when you're talking about the Montenegro or the Balkan players and teams being a bit behind, I see Slovenia as like the great hope in that regard, that they could actually play the way that's necessary to hit the top. They're not there yet, but there are the stepping stones towards that. And for France, Sweden, Denmark, Norway, they are already making that change. So Montenegro will have to start from the bottom, basically. They'll start all over again with the likes of Jovanka leaving. Majda Mamedovic, she was replaced very well at this championship. So seeing this new generation of players coming through for the first time is very exciting. We could have had an amazing young player category for this championship.
Yeah.
And already a bunch of them are in the all-star team, so it's almost not needed. And then there's the likes of Switzerland, who, you know, they're going to host the European Championship in 2 years. They'll be one of the co-hosts. And they've shown with a bunch of 17 and 18-year-olds that they can play a bit of handball as well.
They can do a better job than North Macedonia.
They can do a better job than North Macedonia.
Which is not hard.
Yeah, for me, it was a lot of new faces in that way. A new generation for teams and teams having to adapt handball as well. And I think Denmark and Norway, our finalists today, have shown just how much that is necessary for the rest of Europe and the rest of the world to start thinking as well. So exciting times in that regard for the sport.
That's very nice. So my conclusion would be, It's very hard to admit this now, but France weren't tested. I can really admit now that France definitely weren't tested in their group in Skopje. And no, for me, the bronze medal match was the highlight of the day. I know that sounds weird to say that, but I don't know if you were just saying it earlier. No. It was absolutely incredible. Like those Montenegro players gave absolutely every shred of energy. Jokovic was crying lots of the game.
Yeah, there was
seems like Marta Batinovic as well. Like
every save she made, she collapsed.
Like they played at 110% the whole game, and it took them every bit of every handball they know from when they started playing when they were 9 years old to get over the line today. And it was an absolute struggle, and it was such a pleasure to be in the arena and see that. And that was just an amazing thing to witness. And the scenes after was just limbs everywhere, coaches falling, Popovich falling all over the floor, got tripped. And she was celebrating, fell backwards.
Oh, they can handle another fall. This
would be good to have that on your SD card.
Hopefully, it's on the other SD card. Yeah, I know. It's just like that was the highlight of the whole tournament for me, was Montenegro winning bronze. And as you said, Chris, the fact that Norway brought in so many new players and then were able to bounce back from beating Denmark. I think it felt inevitable the whole game, really. I was like, even though when they were down the first half, I was kind of thinking,
Is it annoying that we were all thinking that?
Yeah.
How annoying is that? How annoyingly good are Norway?
It was annoyingly good, and also how I kind of feel they felt that as well. They didn't ever seem that stressed. They're just kind of like, this is a long game, it's 60 minutes. When it hits 45 minutes, we're going to get back into it. And they pretty much did then. Yeah. And
where were you? What were you doing during the game? Where were you? What did you pick up? Because I think you always have an interesting insight based on where you are, and whether it's benches, whether it's the crowd. What were the vibes you were feeling down courtside?
For the final?
Yeah.
As I said, I think the just calmness from the Norway bench, I felt like they felt it enough experience there with those core players to get back into it. And I was that last goal that Norway scored, when it kind of just sealed the deal, and Norm Mork did a knee slide basically off the court right up into the camera and was shouting her head off, and it was right place, right time.
Wow.
And you can see that on Instagram stories if you go check it out.
Nice,
one of my favorite shots, I think, of the whole tournament. It was good fun. It just had to be I was in the right place, and she just did a knee slide right in front of me.
And you were down there after with the celebrations as well, and after the trophy being handed out, we were up here. So what were you saying? What were you feeling?
The celebrations were way bigger for the bronze medal.
Yeah,
I mean they were quite big for the Norway one, but it was the Norway have been here a lot of times before, and those players have won this a few times already. A lot of them. And
was that you in the dressing room? Or was it someone else?
No,
I think Nagore was there.
I was in Nagore. It wasn't the biggest celebration I've ever seen.
A lot of relief.
Yeah. I think if that was a Danish locker room, we would have seen something a bit more spectacular. Mm.
Yeah. I know, but it was. Yeah, I mean, they were obviously delighted, but I felt like after the bronze medal match, everything dipped a little bit in terms of like.
But like the energy, I just got sapped. It reminded me of, was it the semi-final at the men's EHF Euro 2022, where it was Croatia against...
Are you talking about 2020 when Croatia beat Norway?
2020 when Croatia beat Norway after that
epic game.
Double extra time.
Yeah. Karadžić assists to Musa by every meets of chance.
And then there was a game after that, and it was just like no one could even watch that game because everyone was so exhausted that they couldn't even watch that game. That everyone had to go outside and go for a smoke or something.
All right, so favorite. I mean, we've interviewed about 40 players over the course of this championship, which has been amazing. Also, in terms of like revealing the personalities, favorite person you've heard from during this championship, Alex.
For me, the best one I think was Cleopatra Darlow after the loss at the media call. Just very reflected and a great insight into Norm Mork's penalty game. I think that was it was nice to hear that.
I'm going to go all the way back to our first preview podcast where we spoke to Jaukovic and Radicevic, two players that were just the absolute stars of this tournament. And I have never seen a more physically beaten up person than Jaukovic in those last seconds of that bronze medal match. She was, I don't know how, at one stage she got a huge bang on the floor. I think her head fell, her neck was being supported by the physio. I was thinking, okay, that's it. This is, you know, she has to come off.
2 minutes later.
2 minutes later, she's on the court again. And I'm like, what are you doing? What are you made of? And she made the score the final goal, and she still kept going. So it was incredible. And kind of looking back on that interview, I don't know, I didn't kind of read into that kind of warrior spirit. She didn't come across that way. You know, we know she's a fantastic player, but she was almost a little bit shy and kind of, she was the young player sitting beside a legend, and now she is a legend herself. So it's kind of this growth for her.
That's the best we've ever seen her play, though, no?
Oh, yeah.
But hands down.
Has to be.
Yeah, let's not forget that she's coming back from a knee
injury.
I remember that. I think I said in some Twitch preview show, Jaukovic will play probably good and important role, and there are comments, but she's coming back. She doesn't play so good for Brest, even though she did. I mean, Brest is not playing good, but she plays good.
I don't know if this is an actual quote.
Jaukovic, from women's handball, Jaukovic.
But it probably
if they had torn off my leg, I would have gone back and hopped on one. That's great. Because we joked with Jovanka Radicevic that it was kind of like this farewell tour was a tour of her career as well, because it started in Podgorica, where her
122 decibels was the noise made by the Montenegrin fans in that arena.
Moved on to Skopje, where she had those years with Vardar and played this short-lived legendary team. And then here in Ljubljana, Krim, her current club. And it was this amazing farewell journey for her. She played so well and just that lobbed penalty as well in extra time where she dropped it over the head of Darla. Just like, she lived up to every expectation. And great story for her as well. Do you find, you were joking with me, what do Montenegro need to do to win a medal? You are always saying, you're doubting them every step of the way. Do you finally believe in them now?
I believe in the beauty of sport now. Because I think I was a little bit too cold and too analytical with some of my predictions of the better team, the better squad, better players will win. But the beauty of sport is that having the energy, having something to play for, having fans, having just the fire inside you does give you 20 extra percent. And those 20 extra percent get you a bronze medal. So I believe in sport.
There you go. That's a nice one.
I mean, the next time you see Montenegro, you could see them in a friendly against Poland getting absolutely hockeyed.
Exactly.
And they have that in them then to do that as well.
Yeah.
But then when it really comes down to it at a final tournament,
they find a way.
I don't know, there's something about those Balkan nations, they can really dig into a different...
Yeah, the fans helped today. The fans helped massively today. Yeah. They gave them the energy that they desperately needed, in my opinion.
My favorite thing about the Montenegro fans in the arena is when you're like, oh, there's none of them here. And then all of a sudden, it's like the bus pulls up and they all walk in together and all come in through all the different entrances singing. And it's just like, it's unlike any other fan base. Like French people come in, they all come in ones by twos and they all eventually fill up. But it's like literally a bus pulled up and they're all coming in.
Yeah.
Obviously, they were all together outside somewhere partying, but I love it because it's like, oh, here they are. The whole arena just changes.
Now we just need to find where the after party is for the Montenegrin fans.
Oh, my goodness.
The team is traveling back to Montenegro, even though there are some. I mean, I didn't want to say, or maybe I want to say that there's a huge national pride for Montenegro. A lot of things that people don't know. The political situation is not so good there. So I think this team played additional 20-30% for the people there to show them. Because I know by fact that until yesterday evening there were negotiations if their plane will be able to land in Podgorica tonight after 11 o'clock. We are speaking about stuff which are not easy. I think also that gave them energy, and coming back, I mean, they played extra time without Trajicic and without Grbic.
Yeah.
And they still won with Brnovic, yeah, again with 2 minutes penalty, with one seventh of Jaukovic on the court, healthy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean that, kudos for that, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, full kudos to all of our medalists. And we'll have to save the France talk for another day when they finally get tested and come through a test. Right, Brian?
Yes, exactly.
And, I think now with the hour almost reaching 11:30, and I think we can wrap it up here. Any final words from anyone?
Have the people at home ever seen what Clemens looks like?
Oh, Clemens has been on stream a couple of times.
Oh, yes, okay.
Clemens brought the trophy on at one point, and then he brought me and Alex some nice refreshing
herbal teas.
Watch along for the second game. So Clements has popped up a couple of times. Would you bring him on one last time to say goodbye? Come on, Clements. Come up here.
Go on. No, everyone has seen you, but no one has heard your voice. Yes. So
favorite.
It's going to be a mystery.
Clements, your favorite moment of the tournament that you saw every single minute of?
Oh yeah,
it
was the professional favorite moment. Probably the next 2 hours tearing down the studio, sweating in the suit and shirt, and then not going to bed afterwards.
A few more teas,
and then a few more teas.
All right, I think we can wrap it up there from the podcast side. Also from Twitch, the home of handball. That's it, Alex. You started all of this on Twitch at this championship. You wrap it all up. Sing us out.
What's the Montenegro national anthem?
The end is near.
No, we'll leave it there. Great tournament. Worthy winners. Disappointment for Denmark, but joy for Montenegro. From me, Alex Kulesh, Chris O'Reilly, Brian Campion, and our special guests, Nedzad Smajlagic. Goodbye. Sugar good now, bring it now up. Get to them, pump it, be done like a star. I feel like a number keep up. Summon the dragon, so lost smooth operator. I saw the sign coming on. Then I dimmed me what? Business for me is all of my chicas come and say, yo soy la. Yo soy la luz de mi vida, hay más que hablar.